And here Goebbels unleashes the propaganda machine. Does anybody know what Goebbels was called in America during the war? He was referred to as a fat fool. That's wrong for two reasons. Firstly, he wasn't fat. And secondly, he was hardly a fool. He had three different doctors in three different disciplines. He was a legitimate intellectual. I'm not a big fan of America bashing, but it's truly an American problem that we belittle our enemies. When I was a kid, I'm 27, they called Ho Chi Minh a fat fool. At least he was fat. But he wasn't a fool, he had conquered the Orient. If you belittle your enemy, you don't take them seriously. Israel referred to the Hezbollah as a bunch of rinky-dink terrorists. They were Israel tourneys. It's a take-home message, not to belittle your enemies. I don't mean obsequious, lavish, oh, Swami. But one day they may be your adversary, and you have to be prepared. They referred to Goebbels as a fat fool. Who did Hitler look like more than anyone else? Charlie Chaplin. But there's nothing funny or comedian or spoofy about Hitler. If you belittle them, you don't take them seriously. Then comes in the fall of 1938, the Munich Conference, where the great fool, the great appeaser, Neville Chamberlain, capitulates, hands over Czechoslovakia, and Hitler concludes, I have now Austria, Czechoslovakia, I've not yet fired a shot. My people are becoming flabby and soft. I have to prepare them for a world war. World war means all kinds of difficulties on the home front, body bags, deprivation, scarcity. How do we do this? Always the same recipe, picking on the Jews. All Jews of Polish ancestry are thrown over the border, literally thrown over the border. Sir Martin Gilbert wrote, the road out of Germany was red with Jewish blood. And one person who was banished was a tailor named Zundel Grinspan, who sends a postcard to some Herschel in Paris studying university describing how appalling the conditions are. No roof over their head, no food, no shelter. They must sleep in pigsties with their excrement still present. And Herschel's appalled. Herschel wants to alert the world, gets hold of a pistol, goes into the German embassy in Paris and shoots the first ambassador. He sees the first person, a thoroughly unimportant ambassador, Ernst von Roth, who ironically was under investigation from the Gestapo for being too soft on the Jews. Shooting him November 7, 1938, 2 days later, he will die from his wounds. Actually, we now know the one who actually killed him was Hitler's personal physician from a page article in the New York Times 2.5 years ago. But now there's the canard, which is going to be the catalytic enzyme for Kristallnacht. Every synagogue in Germany, subsequent Austria, is put to the torch. Every Jewish home is raided. All Jewish businesses are destroyed and pillaged and plundered. The night, the broken glass. All glass in Germany, like all of Europe, is imported from Belgium. More than 7 times a yearly import of glass is destroyed. Jews cannot collect the 25 million Reichmarks of insurance. They have to repair their shops at their own expense, and then they are organized, expropriated, and given to the Germans. And the Jewish communities find 1 billion Reichmarks to pay for the damage as if they were responsible, which takes German Jewry into grinding poverty. And again, these images of Kristallnacht are broadcast to the West, which is going to be the impetus to create the Avignon Conference. There is agitation in America to do something. In the present United States, named after the highway in Manhattan, FDR, who's the constant politician, wants to do something grandiose that will accomplish nothing. 33 countries are invited, and it says in an invitation, no one is expected to do a thing or change the quota. And every country gets up at the conference and explains how they are going to do nothing. Says Australia. Australia today, 2016, is 95% barren and uninhabited. And Australia says, you don't have any room for the Jews. Argentina says, we've taken more than the United States. That is true. France says, we have more than anyone else. That was true. And Switzerland, Heinrich Reitmann, a rabid vitriolic anti-Semite, that is Swiss border control, says, we have as much need for the Jews as the Germans have. It was a fiasco. A reporter for the Health Tribune wrote, Avignon backwards spells naive. Mm. And the other one who got the message was Hitler, who was doubled over in laughter. Here's a conference on behalf of the Jews, and nobody wants them. He got the message. He can do whatever he wants, and the world wouldn't give a flying flip. In May of 39 is the story of the SS St. Louis, the most famous, or perhaps infamous, of the doomed ships. On board are 937 Jewish passengers, all of them with legitimate paperwork to go to Cuba. And it cost them a fortune. They borrowed. They have the money, the passage to go to Cuba. When the boat is docked in Havana, it is tethered to the port. You can look up and see the passengers. The Cubans want the bride. That's very common in Central America, Latin America, South America. I don't have to explain to Angelinos to expect the bride. I'll bet you one of the first words you learn in Spanish is el bribo. Now, if they want a bride, what should you do? Let's try that again. If you want a bride, what should you do? Yeah. How did they send Staples? That was simple. But the leader of American Jewry, his name was Rabbi Stephen S. Wise, whom we used to call Hagodol Hazeh. Rabbi Stephen S. Wise was the quintessential reform rabbi. Good crop of hair, well-built, stage presence, rhetorical abilities, cushy at FDR, Eleanor, members of the cabinet. But his agenda was not to violate the law. To give a bribe violates the law. And the irony of ironies was that had it required millions to be housed and educated, they would come up with the money. But not to violate the law. The captain of the ship, Gustav Schroeder, a German, was a benevolent, magnanimous humanitarian. He figures, well, of the 937, 736 of these passengers have American visas, just to only be bound in 3 months' time. America should be a humanitarian country. So he steams the ship up and down the eastern seaboard. How does America greet the boat? With a Coast Guard cutter to intercept. Had they jumped off and swam the 40 miles to Miami, had that been doable, they would have been sent back. And this boat that was docked on the west, which country accepts it? Not one on the face of the earth. And they go back to Europe, and almost all of them perish. So this brings us to, how many of you are familiar with the Musi negotiations? That means you don't read enough Teller books, but that's rectifiable. More about that later. On the table, what happened was, from the time that Germany attacked its arch ally, June 22nd, 1941, and the Russians were taken so much by surprise, Stalin suffered a nervous breakdown, and he was always suspicious of his generals. He had them assassinated all the time. So he had no general staff to repel the Germans. He had to take out officers from the Gulag concentration camps. In the end, which Russian general was able to defeat the Germans? General Frost, right? The Russian winter. He got, within 2 weeks, he's already on the lips of Moscow. But he got as far as Stalingrad. I don't have a map to show you, but as far as the Jewish area, Belarus, that was annihilated. It was a blitzkrieg, a juggernaut, and right then begins the final solution. Jews are taken out, forced to dig mass graves, pits, trenches, anti-tank trenches, and there they are shot in the best of circumstances. But I shall spare you. This was the German general staff said the biggest mistake of Germany was beginning the war 1 month too late. When the Russian winter began, the Russians were adept at fighting in the cold, the tanks froze, the oil could not move. And then, within the first 4 months of the war, Germany had lost 734,000 troops. I was taught in high school, I wasn't in high school very long, I was taught the most important day of World War II was D-Day. It's not true. And for a second, I helped me to belittle the American and the Canadian and the British amphibious attack units. But by the time D-Day happened, Germany was flat on its back. It was hemorrhaging. but they are not about to lose the war against the Jews. And I use this title, the title of Lucy Davidowitz's book, because people mistakenly believe that Hitler blamed the Jews to gain power. Incorrect. The sad fact is he gained power in order to murder the Jews. How else can you explain the fact when he's losing on two fronts? And that's when he's reinforcements to evacuate from Greece and materiel to the east. All the transfer orders from the very top cannot be deflected or taken away from the destruction of Hungarian Jewry because it's the war against the Jews. One more time. He didn't blame the Jews to gain power. He gained power in order to murder the Jews. So now, on the table are somewhere between 600,000 and 800,000 Jews still alive in the camps. Hitler was more pragmatic than Hitler, and through the offices of the Bad Hatzolah in America. Not to be confused with the Ambulance Corps, the great rabbis of America, Rav Aaron Cutler, Rav Blazer Silva, Rav Avraham Kalmanovich, Rav Yashar Ber Soloveitchik, and important lay leaders, Mike Tress, Irving Unum, Stephen S. Klein, Louis Septimus. They are about to argue to try and save these 800,000 Jews. What Himmler wants at first is medication, which they can't come up with, trucks, which they can't come up with. And then he says 5 million Swiss francs, or the equivalent of about 1 million US dollars. The Bad Hatzolah does not have a million, but the Joint Distribution Committee does have $1 million. Rav Aaron Cutler, the most senior sage in America, who looks like the quintessential Lithuanian Rosh Yeshiva, Yeshiva Dean, short, gray, stooped, maybe even a tad of dandruff, long black coat. He doesn't look very worldly, but the fact is he's extraordinarily clever and understood political science. Goes before the Joint Distribution Committee to beg them for $1 million to save what would have been the greatest rescue effort in the history of history. The Joint refuses. We can't violate the law. It means violating the British blockade, which is sacrosanct. It means, it's after Pearl Harbor, it means trading with the enemy, which is a felonious crime. For all I know, it's a treasonous crime. To the great rabbis of America, it is despicable to violate American law, and it's odious to give money to the Nazis. And yet, there's a higher law. And the higher law is pikuach nefesh, to save a life. And the higher law is pidyon shvuim, to rescue a captive. And the higher law is arvut, responsibility, one Jew towards his brother. Rabbi Cutler pleads and cajoles and wheedles, and finally say, okay, we'll give you the money, provided you get a license, that we can give the money to the Nazi enemy. Only one person, all of America, would authorize to give this license. And this, of course, was the president named after the highway. So Rabbi Aaron Cutler, who does not converse in English, travels to Washington with Irving Unum from Young Israel, his translator, his right hand. They go to the White House, and apparently the president felt that the plight of 800,000 Jews was not important enough for his time. He sends them to his hyper-assimilated Secretary of the Treasury, Henry Morgenthau Jr. And you can imagine, being a secretary in FDR's cabinet, you have to be an extremely assimilated Jew, which he was. And there's no way in the world he's going to authorize $1 million of taxpayer money to go to the Nazi enemy. And again, Rabbi Cutler pleads and cajoles and wheedles and begs, and he will not give in. In desperation, Rabbi Cutler says to Unum, tell him that you are worthless and Washington is meaningless if you can't save the life of one child in Europe. There's no way in the world that Irving Unum is going to tell Henry Morgenthau Jr. in the White House that you are worthless and Washington is meaningless. And he gives him a milquetoast version. The rabbi's very disappointed. We hope in the future it can be a greater help. Rabbi Aaron Cutler was, as I like to joke, an observant Jew. And he noticed that what he sees from Henry Morgenthau Jr.'s expression, that what he has said had not been accurately translated. He said, Unum, Zabun Chlaris Chalkus, I tell him precisely what I told you. At that point, Irving Unum, not about to violate the dictates of the most important rabbi of the generation, looks down the shoes to see if his shoelaces are tied. Socks are pulled up in other matters of sartorial concern. He says in a barely audible tone, Mr. Secretary, the rabbis asked me to inform you that you are worthless and Washington's meetings. At that point, Henry Morgantown Jr. collapses on the table like this, what appears to be eternity. When he finally raises his head, his eyes are deltas of red, their tears cascading down the street. He said, "Tell the rabbi, I have not forgotten who I am, and I'll put my neck on the chopping block to save my brethren." Ultimately, this plan was scuttled by American Jewry and Swiss Jewry, and Hitler himself intervened to make sure it wouldn't happen. But Henry Morgantown Jr. will go down in history as one who was willing to sacrifice his career to save his brethren. And here's an important take-home message. In life, we have to make difficult decisions. If you go for the convenience, it'll always be forgotten. But if you make difficult decisions, that's what will be remembered. The more obvious example is Oscar Schindler was a dishonest businessman and womanizer, and he saved nearly 1,200 Jews during the Holocaust. Had it not been for the latter, if he'd be remembered, and that's a major if, he'd be remembered as a creep. And not only Schindler is synonymous with heroism, bravery, courage, self-sacrifice, synonymous. Like Vaseline means petroleum jelly, and Kleenex means tissues, and Q-tips means cotton swabs, Schindler means self-sacrifice. He changed his name. And we can too. Okay.